The role of carotid endarterectomy is the prevention of strokes in patients with systemic disease of the vascular system. The indications for the procedure are varied, but the chief indication is transient ischemia when the symptoms of cerebral ischemia are transient, intermittent, and self-resolving. The results of surgical correction of the area of carotid stenosis are excellent. The operation may be considered in some patients who have recovered from old strokes who develop new symptoms. Mild intracranial disease with severe proximal disease is another indication for carotid endarterectomy. The two principal indications are asymptomatic high-grade stenosis and transient ischemia. Duplex ultrasound blood flow imaging studies with or without magnetic resonance angiography, MRE, or contrast angiography are used to visualize the arch carotids and vertebral vessels. This allows accurate documentation of any areas of stenosis as well as the extent of the collateral blood supply. Surgical improvement is minimal in patients with complete occlusion of the internal carotid artery, and operation is not usually recommended for patients with established long-standing occlusion. The risks of increasing cerebral damage or of the patient suffering hemiplegia are ever present, and the patient and family should be thoroughly informed of the risks. A thorough medical evaluation of the cardiovascular system with special attention to the coronary arteries is indicated. Other medical problems, including diabetes, must be under complete control. The incidence of stroke is greater in patients with contralateral carotid occlusion, and one-stage bilateral carotid endarterectomy is inadvisable because of the increased incidence of complications. At least a week or more should separate two procedures. The operation may be delayed in patients with acute strokes, allowing them to stabilize for 4 to 6 weeks at that time. Angiographic studies and operation can be considered. The patient is placed in a supine position with the head slightly extended and turned toward the contralateral side. After routine skin preparation, the operative field is draped to expose the mastoid process superiorly, the angle of the mandible anteriorly, the manubrium and clavicle inferiorly, to the trapezius posteriorly. The incision is made along the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle from the mastoid process to a point 2/3 of the distance to the sternoclavicular joint, figure 1. The incision is carried through the platysma muscle, exposing the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle, which is then retracted later ally to expose the carotid sheath. Care must be taken to avoid making the upper end of the incision too far anteriorly, where the marginal mandibular branch of the facial nerve may be injured in its course just inferior to the horizontal ramus of the mandible. Such an injury results in paralysis of the lower lip. In the cephalid portion of the incision, the greater auricular nerve and sensory branches of the cervical plexus often can be identified and preserved. If exposure is not compromised, injury to these nerves will result in a sensory deficit involving the earlobe or the angle of the mandible. Gentle self-retaining retractors may be positioned at this time to provide maximal exposure. The omohyoid muscle may be retracted inferiorly or divided to permit exposure of the common carotid artery, depending upon the required extent of the procedure. The anatomy of the neck must be understood clearly so that inadvertent injury to nearby cranial nerves can be avoided. Figure 2, the vagus nerve lies within the carotid sheath, generally in a posterolateral position. Injury will result in vocal cord paralysis. The hypoglossal nerve passes superficial to the carotid arteries 1 to 2 cm cephalid to the carotid bifurcation. Injury will result in deviation of the tongue and dysphagia. The ansa hypoglossi branches from the hypoglossal nerve as it crosses the internal carotid artery and passes inferiorly to innervate the strap muscles. THIS may be sacrificed without significant consequence to facilitate exposure of the more distal internal carotid artery, allowing the hypoglossal nerve to be gently retracted superiorly. The carotid body is in the crotch of the carotid bifurcation. Dissection in this area may result in hypertension and bradycardia, cardiovascular effects that can be blocked effectively by injecting the carotid body with 1% lidocaine. The facial nerve is at the most cephalid extent of the incision and should be well out of the field anteriorly. Figure 2. After the described exposure has been obtained, the facial vein is divided, exposing the carotid bifurcation. Figure 3. The carotid sheath is entered and opened superiorly and inferiorly. A vessel loop is passed about the common carotid artery proximally and distally. A vessel loop is passed around the external carotid artery to facilitate later placement of a vascular clamp. A vessel loop or a OO silk ligature then is passed doubly around the superior thyroid artery as a pot's tie to provide vascular control. The internal carotid artery is then dissected circumferentially at a 0.1 cm distal to palpable disease and encircled with a vessel loop. Great gentleness is required and care is taken during this dissection to prevent plaque embolization if selective shunting is to be used. Appropriate monitoring equipment, a transducer, extension tubing, and a 22-gauge needle must be readied and carefully flushed with saline to free it of bubbles or particulate debris. Clamps are placed across the external carotid artery and common carotid artery, after which the needle is placed within the carotid artery to measure the carotid stump pressure. Figure 4, stump pressures greater than 40 to 50 millimeters of mercury document significant collateral blood flow and are associated with a lower incidence of cerebrovascular accident. Care must be taken in the presence of extensive or ulcerated plaques to avoid plaque embolization with this maneuver. Some rely upon continuous electroencephalographic monitoring to gauge the adequacy of collateral blood flow and the requirement for intraluminal shunting. Others choose to shunt all patients routinely, and still others may choose not to shunt patients at all but attain acceptable results. Heparin is now given intravenously by the anesthesiologist at the surgeon's discretion. Bulldog clamps are placed across the internal carotid artery, external carotid artery, and common carotid artery in sequence. An incision then is made on the anterolateral surface of the common carotid artery just inferior to the bifurcation pot. Scissors then are used to elongate the incision proximally and distally across the area selected for endarterectomy. Figure 5. Care must be taken to extend the arteriotomy distally to a point beyond the end of the atheromatous plaque so that the endarterectomy can be performed entirely under direct vision. The incision is carried through the thickened intima into the lumen. The line of cleavage is within the media, leaving the adventitia and media externa for closure as indicated by the arrows. Figure 6. F. Intraluminal shunting is elected with a Pruitt Inahara shunt. It needs to be flushed and prepped ahead of time. Heparinized saline is flushed through the irrigating port and hemostats are placed on the proximal and distal limbs of the shunt directly adjacent to the irrigating port. The distal end is inserted first and the balloon is gently inflated to seal off back bleeding around the shunt. Figure 7. The distal hemostat is opened and the distal limb aspirated back through the irrigating limb to remove all air. The hemostat is reapplied. The proximal end of the shunt is then inserted into the common carotid artery and the balloon gently inflated to prevent any anti-grade flow around the shunt. Figures 8 and 9. Overinflation is to be avoided to prevent tearing of the intima or prolapsing of the balloon over the end of the shunt and occluding flow. The proximal hemostat is removed and the limb aspirated through the irrigating port to remove any air or debris. The aspirating process should be repeated one more time and the hemostats removed to establish flow through the shunt. The shunt is checked with the Doppler probe to check for flow and the endarterectomy is then commenced. With experience and planning, placement of such a shunt should consume no more than 60 to 90 seconds. Endarterectomy then is begun in the distal common carotid artery, using a freer elevator, blunt spatula, or a mosquito hemostat. The appropriate endarterectomy plane usually is identified easily in the mid to outer media, leaving a smooth, glistening reddish-brown arterial wall behind. Figure 10. This dissection is continued quite carefully in an attempt to elevate the plaque circumferentially. A blunt-tipped right-angle clamp is often valuable. Figure 11. The plaque then is divided proximally with the pot's scissors to facilitate exposure. The endarterectomy then proceeds distally in a meticulous fashion, care being taken to maintain a single endarterectomy plane. The most important aspect of the procedure is the delicate feathering of the endarterectomy at the distal boundary of the atheromatous plaque. No flap or shelf can be tolerated, since a technical fault will result in dissection after restoration of prograde FLO with subsequent thrombosis and probable neurologic catastrophe. Plaque is removed similarly from the external carotid orifice, allowing removal of the specimen. Figure 12. All residual debris then is removed carefully with forceps in a circumferential direction. A kidney sponge also may be helpful in clearing the field of debris. Heparinized saline is used to irrigate the field, allowing free removal of clot. Forceful irrigation distally may reveal elevation of a distal flap that may require attention or tacking sutures. Figure 13. Rarely, tacking sutures will be required to prevent subintimal dissection. Figure 14. THA's horizontal mattress sutures of 70 polypropylene are placed at intervals circumferently, using double-ended sutures passed from inside out and tied externally. Figure 14. Occasionally, a very large artery with a short length of arteriotomy can be closed, starting from both ends with 60 polypropylene sutures in a running manner using double-ended vascular sutures. Care must be taken not to narrow the vessels during closure, especially the internal carotid artery distally when approximately 1 cm of arteriotomy remains to be closed. The inlying shunt is doubly cross-clamped with straight mosquito hemostats and divided. The two ends of the shunt are then removed, first distally, then proximally, and bulldog clamps are reapplied. Figure 15. The remainder of the arteriotomy then is closed rapidly. Great care being taken to flush the system of particulate debris and air. Figure 16. Following completion of closure, the clamps are removed in a specific order: external carotid artery, common carotid artery, and finally internal carotid artery. This order minimizes the possibility of cerebral embolization, permitting potential emboli to be flushed into the external carotid system preferentially. The completed endarterectomy must have thorough hemostasis and no residual stenosis. Patch angioplasty with prosthetic material or autologous vein is preferred, especially when dealing with small vessels, in women, or following technical misadventure where there is fragmentation or damage to the arterial wall. Mattress sutures of double-ended 60 polypropylene are placed at either end. Both needles of each end suture pass through the patch from outside to in, and then pass from lumen to the outside of the carotid artery where the knots are tied. Figure 17. This provides a broad-based loop that anchors the graft. The inferior or proximal suture B is run superiorly in a continuous manner on the medial side of the graft and tied to a, figure 18, sutures A and B are then run towards the midpoint on the lateral side of the arteriotomy when approximately 1 cm of arteriotomy remains to be closed in the mid-portion of the incision. The balloons are deflated and the shunt is cross-clamped with a straight mosquito hemostat. A brisk inflow and backflow are allowed so as to flush the area as the two ends of the shunt are removed, first distally, then proximally. Figure 19. The bulldog clamps are reapplied or the vessel loops cinched down so as to secure active bleeding. The remainder of the arteriotomy then is closed rapidly, with great care being taken to flush the region of particulate debris and air. Figure 20. Following completion of closure, the clamps are removed in a specific order: external carotid artery, common carotid artery, and finally internal carotid artery. This sequence minimizes the possibility of cerebral embolization, permitting potential emboli to be flushed into the external carotid system preferentially. The completed endarterectomy must have thorough hemostasis and no residual stenosis. Figure 21. Upon completion, a Doppler or duplex ultrasound study is performed to verify an unobstructed blood flow. Any suspicion of recurrent thrombosis is an urgent indication to reopen the arteriotomy and remove the thrombus. Finally, many surgeons keep the patient in the operating room until they awaken without a neurologic deficit. If any neurologic changes are present, the operative site is re-explored immediately. Meticulous hemostasis must be obtained to prevent cervical hematoma and possible respiratory embarrassment from tracheal compass cyan. If heparinization has been used, protamine sulfate may be given to reverse anticoagulation. The wound is closed in layers, approximating the sternocleidomastoid muscle and cervical fascia, the platysma, and the skin. A small closed suction elastic drain may be brought out the inferior margin of the incision at the surgeon's discretion. Bleeding into the wound may occur from excessive anticoagulation, improper hemostasis, seeping from the suture line, or postoperative hypertension. Tracheal obstruction may occur and requires endotracheal intubation. Re-exploration of the wound may be indicated for hematoma evacuation. The effects of injury to sensory as well as motor nerves can range from minor losses in skin sensation to drooping of the corner of the mouth resulting from injury to the marginal branch of the facial nerve. The patient should remain in the intensive care unit for physiologic monitoring. Postoperative hypertension must be avoided by adequate blood and fluid replacement. Over medication and cardiovascular complications must be considered likewise. Hypertension is to be avoided because of the danger of an acute stroke or disruption of the arterial closure. Major neurologic deficits to occur occasionally. Cerebral edema is treated with steroids, diuretics, and hypertonic parenteral solutions. Self-limiting headaches may occur following the repair of very stenotic lesions. Hyponatremia and hypernatremia may result in water intoxication with cerebral edema.